Hey there. True story. Recently, a group of men reportedly with Irish accents were knocking on people's doors around town, and they were offering resident services for work on their home, from chimney work to roofing. They promised to cut you a deal on the work on your house, and they demand cash up front. And then once they start, they jack the price way up and then disappear a day or two later. They're gone. Your house is torn apart and they're nowhere to be found. In my neck of the woods, we refer to these unscrupulous characters as gypsies. This video is geared towards homeowners, but if you're a professional contractor, you need to know this stuff, not only to protect yourself, your reputation, but your clients, and just to be a better, more professional contractor. So if somebody promised you something that's too good to be true, it probably is. Look, only a small percentage of contractors are bad apples, and even less than gypsies. Fortunately, scammers and con artists are pretty easy to spot, as long as your frugality doesn't blind you to the clues. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about some red flags to help identify fraudulent contractors and scams. So anybody who knocks on your door for business, looking for work, no. Most legitimate contractors do not go door to door for work. Often these type of approaches are gypsy scams, or the pretend contractor will offer a low price and then pressure the homeowner for a quick decision, and oftentimes a rash decision, and it's usually involving the elderly. Actually, check the contractor's name and business address. Google them and call the number on a business card if they give you one. Oftentimes these numbers are not real, they just ring, and the business name on the card does not have a real street address. It's not real. Ideally, contact legitimate contractors for their input on repair and get other quotes. Check references. Another one is having leftover material from a previous job. This hoax is usually run by driveway paving company scammers who say they have some leftover hot top material, asphalt, that can't be returned. They pull right up to your house, and you know, typically they have the load of product right with them, and they give you a great price, or it seems like it, to resurface your driveway. Oftentimes the price seems too good to be true, but I guarantee you the work will be shoddy. Usually they don't have the proper equipment to flatten the asphalt, and within a year that driveway is gonna fall apart, heave, or crack. The key here is never hire a contractor on the spot, whether it's a driveway paver or a remodeling contractor. Take your time, check contractors out, check their references, make sure they have a good reputation and do quality work. How about asking for money upfront or demanding cash? This is probably the most common scam. The contractor explains that because he has to order materials or rental equipment to get the job started, he needs maybe 30 or 40% of the project up front. And once you've paid, one of two things happen, right? He disappears on you, or he starts the work and comes up with extra work that's needed. So to protect yourself, ensure that the contract uses a contract, includes a payment schedule with dates and the amount of each payment in dollars at each stage of the work. In Massachusetts, my deposit is required in advance at the start of the work, and it cannot exceed 1/3 of the total contract price or actual cost of material or equipment that has to be special ordered or custom made, in advance to make sure that the work will proceed on schedule. Progress payments in your contract should be made after significant work, and the final payment cannot be demanded until the contract is completed to the satisfaction of both parties. Speaking of contract, no contract. That's a red flag. Anyone who says the contract isn't needed, that should just put up a flag for you. Make sure a contract outlines specific work done, materials used, price breakdown, and payment schedule, detailed scope of work. While some small subcontractors are repair technicians, plumbers, electricians, they may not work with contractors on a regular basis, larger projects need them. In Massachusetts, any project that I work on larger than $1,000 requires a contract. Since we're on contracts, let's talk about building permits. You're legally required to get a building permit for anything significant in a construction project. That allows building officials to visit the site periodically, confirm the work meets building and safety codes. An unlicensed contractor may try to skirt the rule, and they're going to tell you that it's not needed, or they're going to ask you to pull the permit for them. And you can do that as a DIYer, but you're taking the ownership of the project. So your name's on the permit, and basically you're responsible for the work, not your contractor, and for the inspections. So now the contractor doesn't have to answer to the inspector, you do. All right, let me talk about getting licensed for a sec, because it's not a hard thing to do, and contractors that don't get licensed are lazy, cheap, or not organized. Always demand that a contractor get the permit. So this will weed out the unlicensed contractors and give you added protection and an independent assessment of their work. So look online at the state licensing board to make sure that these guys are licensed. You can do that, it's easy. Every state does this. While we're talking about licensing, let's talk about insurance. Every general contractor you work for or with should have two types of insurance. They should have liability insurance, and if they have employees, workers' compensation insurance. So general liability insurance ensures that your property will be protected in case of damage of the project, fire, flood, whatever. Workers' compensation insurance protects the general contractor's workers in case they're injured on your property. It's liability protection. So once they're on your job and they're working on your project, you come up with unforeseen conditions. The project's underway, perhaps even it's almost complete, and this one hits, right? So suddenly your contractor informs you the agreed upon price has risen due to a bunch of extra work or unforeseen conditions. Maybe he blames it on structural problems, like a missing beam or structural issues or design changes that you made after the job began. Well, this is a real situation in the trades. It's a real issue. Changes to projects mean the contract changes. These should be agreed on in a change order or at least in writing in an email. Now, unforeseen conditions are a real thing, but many unscrupulous, lazy, inexperienced or inexperienced contractors, they use it as a catch-all. Nearly all standard contracts in construction have a provision for unexpected conditions. Generally, the provision will include a description of what is meant by an unexpected or concealed condition, what the contractor should do and when such condition is discovered, and the process to be followed once the condition is confirmed by the owner. Again, the owner has to be on notice immediately. Experienced contractors, for example, like bathroom remodelers, they know what to expect when remodeling, when doing a bathroom remodel. To come back to a client and say they didn't account for new insulation in a wall or subfloor replacement or minor structural work, that's just poor business tactics. Many times the contractor is honest, but it's not organized enough, solvent enough, hardworking enough, or maybe they're just inexperienced and not experienced enough to account for these items in their contract. Although these contractors are sincere, the consequences of like a low bid for this situation or the not listing this situation, it's broken promises, bad work, busted budgets, and in my opinion, it's just not good to do. So how do we handle all these things like unforeseen conditions? Well, if you do the same work all the time, you should know what to expect and include it in a written scope of work in your contract. Now, when unforeseen conditions arise, I refer to my standard section in my contract. And before I even move forward, I put the homeowner on notice, I notify them of the condition, and I put them on notice in writing with a change order. I typically handle change orders like that on a T&M basis. Whatever time it takes, we bill for it. If the conditions require something special like testing, lead paint, asbestos, then all work stops until the material is tested and deemed safe and the client pays for that. That's in my contract. Let's talk about really low bids. So that's a bane in my existence. Get three quotes, right? We all grew up with that advice. It's solid advice. And if you do not have an established relationship with a qualified professional contractor that you've used before in trust, then I suggest you do that. If you do have a contractor like that, hire them. So I suggest that you create a scope of work and use the same specifications, materials, so that all the bids can be bid apples to apples. If you don't have a clear understanding of the scope, then hire a contractor for a consultation and let them do the scope for you. Their sole purpose for hiring them would be to write a written, detailed scope of work for you. Pay them for this. Then offer them the opportunity to bid the project if they'd like. If you get a bid that's a lot less than others, there's usually a reason for it. The cheapest quote is never the best deal, trust me. There are several reasons for really low quotes. So here's a couple of them. Maybe the contractor was spitballing the price. I don't know, that could be a warning that they're lazy, disorganized, complacent, don't know what they're doing. They might not have a clear understanding of your scope and maybe the other contractor did. They plan on doing minimal work. That could be not replacing, you know, old drain pipes or something, wires or insulation. Maybe they're going to cut corners. Maybe they just cut corners. Maybe they're that type of contractor. Maybe they don't have insurance. They might use old materials or reuse stuff and not do new materials for you. Or they might pay their employees under the table. And lastly, they may do the this regularly to get the job. They come in low and then they charge you with extras to once they're involved there. What are you gonna do? So get at least three references for any potential contractor that, and actually check those references. Ask about the quality of work. How's the work stood up over time? What was it like to work with that contractor? And ask about extras and professionalism. That's important, it's reputation. Not every contractor who might come knocking on your door will have, you know, will be up to a scam. But, you know, I just want you guys to be aware of this stuff. So what do you do if you are suspecting a scam? Well, first of all, documentation is your best protection. Keep all communications, emails, texts, anything. Take notes of all conversations. Take photos of all the stages of work, the progress, and any problems. If your contractor is clearly being dishonest, ban him from the job site and report the matter to the Better Business Bureau, your local building inspector, and the state attorney's general's office. Also, contact your lawyer. Find out what your rights are regarding the work, the contract, hopefully, that you signed. Or even reach out to a contractors that you know for advice. Unfortunately, contractors are a plague in our industry, in my industry. So if you're hiring a contractor, it's important to do the research and be aware of these red flags that will help identify potential scams, lazy, shoddy workmanship. I want the trades to be professional. I want to raise the bar. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing. Give us a thumbs up. Leave us a comment. We love hearing from you guys. I'm Rob Robillard, and we'll see you next time here at Concord Carpenter.